On behalf of the Center for Innovation, Incubation and Entrepreneurship here at Vistaram Hyderabad campus, it's my pleasure to have Shri Muralidhar Rao, the National General Secretary of IIT, here for this lecture here. I would ask the director and vice chancellor in charge, Dr. V.S. Rao, to accompany the guest on the stage. Since we are already running a little late, I would like to start the proceedings. It is our pleasure today to have all of you here for this lecture. We are very excited about it. It is a pleasure to have esteemed people from around the country, like Sri Kiran Kalluri from Google Asia at Third Party, Sudhir Srinivasan, overseas BJP Dublin, Mr. Krishna Rao, CEO of Bhutan, Canada, Ms. Jyoti Reddy, Woman Chairperson of National American Credit Association, and Suresh Kochar, General Manager of Apollo Adam. And we have many more other dignitaries which I'm not listing here, but thanks to all of you for coming here. Now I would like our director and Dr. V.S. Rao to introduce the speaker.
Respected Muralidhar Rao garu, National General Secretary BJP, and guests, ladies and gentlemen, faculty and students, it is indeed a great honor for me to welcome Mr. Muralidhar Rao garu to this campus and deliver a LokNeeti talk on India, a global power, powered by growth. This is the need of the hour, sir. You are aptly selected this topic. It is only by empowering the youth that we can become a global leader. Even for other situations, we always depend today on the involvement of youth, even for building institutions. If you have to really become a global power, so certainly you need to have the engagement with youth and involve them, the youth. I am sure that you are going to inspire the youth to engage themselves in this great endeavor of making India a global power. Anyway, the task that is given to me is to introduce the honorable speaker. Shri Muralidhar Rao garu was born in a farmer's family at Korapalli village near Jamikunta, Karimnagar district. He completed his graduation in Marakal, postgraduate education in Usmania University, and obtained MA philosophy in 1985 and MPhil in 1986. He joined the RSS at a very young age. He led Akhila Bharatiya Vidya Parishad ABVP, first in Varangal and later in Hyderabad. He was elected as General Secretary of Usmania University Students Union, in leading away a large number of youth from the violent politics of left-wing extremism during 1980s in North Telangana. Naxals made an attack and he survived that in the year November 1986, right in Usmania University campus. In 1987, ABVP deputed him to Rajasthan. He spent almost 3 years in the state of Rajasthan, where I was actually informally talking to him. He is not a stranger to the state of Rajasthan, so I requested him that he should also visit our BITS Rajasthan campus. In 1991, he moved to Jammu and Kashmir with ABVP to tackle problems faced during insurgency. He rallied the youth and students against fundamentalist forces. Sir, you have contributed immensely in fighting against the insurgents, be it Naxals in Andhra Pradesh or the insurgents in Jammu and Kashmir. He assisted Shri Dattopan Tengadi and Shri Mandandas, senior functionaries of the RSS, along with Shri S. Gurumurthy, in promoting and organizing Swadeshi Jagaran Manch, a movement to protect the Indian rural economy against the onslaught of globalization. I have, in fact, listened to the talks of this Swadeshi Jagaran Manch by Gurumurthy several times. He served as national convener of Swadeshi Jagaran Manch for over 16 years, starting from 1993 to 2008. He has worked for several years to get justice to the victims of Gulf migration, Burmese farmers, BD laborers, weavers, and victims of Singareni open caste mining of North Telangana. Muralidhar Rao joined BJP in January 2009 as attaché to President of BJP Rajnath Singh in 2010. He was made National Secretary in charge of Tamil Nadu and Kerala. He took up the issues of fishermen, was affected by globalization, and organized three regional conventions for East Coast at Vishakhapatnam, for West Coast at Mangalore, for inland fishermen at Varanasi. He had also organized a national convention on weavers at New Delhi in May 2012. He worked as a convener of the Jan Chetana Yatra undertaken by L.K. Advani in 2011 against corruption. So with these words, I would like to invite you to deliver your address.
Today, India a great power, powered by you.
Can I say you? I would like to explain in a way you might not have listened so far. If I visit and address a kind of campus in the name of you in England, Youth of England means is a section of the England society. If I go to Belgium, a reputed campus, and if I say address to the youth of Belgium, there is a section of the Belgium society. Same is with Finland, same is with Nazis. And even to America, many of our young students would like to go and visit and stay sometimes in America. Even if I go and address in America and say that I am addressing the youth of America, you have to take I am addressing the section of the country, section of the society. Whereas when it is done in India, we have to understand it is not the section of the society, it is the entire society. When I say youth of India, if you remove youth of India, there is nothing in India. We are passing to a space of this country today. Youth means India, India means youth. There is nothing else outside. Now it is discussed everywhere. Demographic dividend and all these things. To understand the working age population all over the world, first of all, India is the country, it is not equal to any other country. It is the country, the size of the population, you know, all countries put together, all important countries put together, they cannot match it. Kuwait is also a country. Botswana is also a country. And you have got so many countries. The population of those countries, they are equal numbers in the United Nations of Africa. All are equal, all have one vote for each country. But India, when they say India, it is not just a country. The country has got a population of 127 countries. And in this, now the working age population, if you say age of 15 to age of 64, the working age population which we discuss about, it is now more than 65%. So 65% of the population is the working age population concentrated only in India. You don't have any other country like India. And the dependent population, when I say dependent population, just one child and below age 15, and you take the 65 to 100 years, the whole population, if you put together, the dependent population ratio is 0.55%. So the entire country is working population, the entire country is the population of young people. Below age 30, it is 50% of the population. 50% of the population of this country has the below age 30. So the amount of energy in this kind of energy, you don't have anywhere in the world.
This is a unique situation for the entire country like India and for the generation where we are, where we came from, which we come. This is the generation which is having this kind of situation. So, the important point I would like to mention is that I am addressing the people who are young. I am not addressing the section of the society, I am addressing the entire country which is young and youngest in the world. The average age in 2020, if you take the average age from 15 to 20, 2015 to 20, the average of the age of India is going to be 29. You just understand the age of 29 years, average age of India. The average age of England, or the entire Europe put together, the average age of Europe is going to be 44 years. And the average age of China and the average age of United States of America is going to be 37 years. So the kind of dynamism which India is going to have and is going to manifest and express itself in the coming decade, after 2 decades, till 2040, you cannot have the similar kind of experience and exhibition anyway. So that is the reason when I say, powered by youth is a completely appropriate. India is only powered by youth. No other section is going to build India. It's the youth who are going to build the Indian society, Indian economy, Indian industry, Indian education. And you have to understand another important point. The importance of technology, it has always been. It is not that the importance of technology has come into this world only in 2015 or 2010, or present decade, or present century. Importance of technology has always been there. The societies and the nations which have mastered the technology, which have controlled the technology, they have led the world, they have captained the world, they have guided the world, and they have shaped the human destiny. But you have to understand, always, anywhere in the world, who are the creators of the technology? The creators of the technology, mostly, they come from this section. And the users of the technology are also the two. The way people can use the technology, old people can never use the technology. Caring thing for the world. A person who is scared about the using of the new technology, you must have to take that he has become old. So when the technology is making a rapid progress and the country is also having the young population, it's a happy combination for them. It's a good coincidence, it's a combination. So you have youth power on one side and you have also the power of technology on another side. So in coming days, the days which we want to have in order to shape the India as a powerful country at the global level, not as a hegemonistic country, not as a monopolizing country, but as a country which is interested in distributive justice. As a country which is interested in removing the poverty, empowering everywhere, the vision of India, the vision shared by the visionaries of the India in the past. So this is the important time. So the important institution now have come, and where I am making my speech or my presentation, so you can understand how
powerful and how what kind of opportunities this generation has got, we must have to understand. I understand, I know there are certain issues which are going to be challenges, and there are certain issues which we can call as a gray area, are the difficult times. I am not going to take up those issues now. I am going to take up issues which are very important in making this country as a global power. So this demographic dividend is a very important point which I would like to make. So the second important point, when we talk about India, you know, in the course of my visit now, I went to one incubator center which is shown to me, and also how this institution is working on work integrated, this build project where you are interacting with industry. I call this country as a country of entrepreneurs. You don't have any other country with this kind of entrepreneur power. It is not that we don't have the entrepreneurs and we are building the entrepreneurs. We have the entrepreneurs in this country. You have to understand before getting into the real working of economy, working of real economy. Now we are in 2015. India has led the world for almost more than 1,000 or 1,500 or 2,000 years continuously in an uninterrupted way. Plassey had taken place in 1757, Plassey War. And after Plassey, English people subjugated us and colonized us. And after 1857 mutiny, or the first war of Indian independence, what we call, then English people completely made us a colony of the English crown. If you see, till 1700, before they got defeated, you understand, just in 1700, the share of the global economy, what was the share of global economy? What was the share of India in the global economy? It was more than 24%. You understand? It is not 500 years, it is not 700 years. And the share of the Indian economy in the world trade or world GDP, 20%, 25%, 30%, and 33%, it was like that for the whole, you know, 1,000 years, and we rotated the leadership between China and India. If China was second, India was first, and if India was second, China was first, if China and India put together, we were having the share of more than 40, 45, 50%. And in 1700, the share of America and Europe put together, it was 2% of the world GDP. So who made them rich and who made us poor? So you know, we have to understand, it is not that we are going to bring India and the blank slate, the clean slate, nothing is there, and the Indian society is not functioning, and the Indian economy is not functioning, and the Indian industry is not functioning, and the Indian education and the Indian skills are not completely not there, and in the ladder of the development we are nowhere. And India has to catch up. This kind of information is perpetuated by the distorted knowledge and distorted information. I am here to challenge the kind of technologies. Just to understand, to make the quick this thing, not engineers here, not intelligent students who are here.
population, 4,000 population, not more. And in Tamil Nadu, you see any grand temple. I am not talking about the temple and religion. I am talking about the engineering and architecture. I am talking about the economy and I am talking about the prosperity. I am talking about the design and I am talking about the planning. In 3,000 population, today it is 3,000. What would have been the population of that village in 1700, 1500 or 1000? So at that point of time, our ancestors constructed this kind of engineering marvels, units and technological units. You go to Puri, it is not one corner, everywhere. And even that knowledge base, now I am going to give one important brand introduces a new car. In Srinagar on the highway number one, national highway number one, it is just unrolled and it passes through Hyderabad and it goes to Kanyakumari. By the time it reaches Kanyakumari and it returns, start returning, you will have lakhs of mechanics ready to do the repairing for the car. Where from this technology base has come? BITS Pilani is not training them. No engineering college is not creating this kind of mechanic. So what I am interested in making you is the power of youth, the technological capacity, the absorption capacity of the generation and youth. We must have to understand this has come to these people and society because of the long tradition of knowledge which has been there. So it is not black. So on that basis, now I would like to talk about more than 2,000 clusters, industrial clusters are functioning and creating wealth in this country. I am happy which Pilani students are doing here. Which Pilani students are very ambitious and they want to conquer the world for India. And they want to establish the intellectual superiority at the global level. I am very happy and I am feeling proud. I am very, and I see these kind of intellectual centers, I feel very proud. And when they go to one, this company or that company, multinational company or this technology company, I feel proud. I am not unhappy. The kind of migration which is, you know, people used to call as a dream. Now migration. Migration is a very important tool for India in conquering the world. They are gaining in 2 ways. So we have to understand, are we focusing the real strengths of India? Are we focusing on the real strengths of India? We have the economy. Now I come to the important point, India as a global power means it is not the Mumbai Stock Exchange. India is driven by entrepreneurs today. I am not talking about tomorrow they have to create a new entrepreneur, only then India. India even today is driven by entrepreneurs today. We stand second. 17.6 and 17.9, just Thailand and other society, but no comparison between Thailand and India. India has got entrepreneurs, millions of entrepreneurs. Sir, I have to ask, any institution, leave about BITS Pilani, IIT, any institution, so far after 1947, after becoming free and independent, taken any effort to compile annually the technologies created by the non-formal people. The technologies created in the engineering colleges, I am happy. Technologies created in the engineering institutions, I am happy. Technologies created in the industry, I am happy, formal industry. But I would like to ask, the technologies created in the area where no banks are, where no ICC, CSIR or any other research centers are working. In India, people in villages, the students who are travelers, the students who are not fortunate to have the engineering education or higher technical education, how many of them have created the mind block. This is the only society in the world which has got this kind of level. Farmers are creating this one. Artisans are creating this one. Artisans creating technology means even better steel making technologies. They are creating even more. So the entrepreneurial India, the second important strength through which we are going to become power, or even today major economy, it is because of the entrepreneurial India. It is entrepreneurs of this country who are going to conquer the whole world. Institution launch a project to go and study these kind of clusters where technologies are very important and making the change and earning the foreign exchange for the country. The foreign exchange earners are who? Who are the foreign exchange earners, real exchange earners? Then these are the clusters. It is not one cluster, to more than 2,000 clusters. Go to Rajkot, go to Dimar, go to Shivakashi, go to anywhere. So this kind of, so entrepreneurs are the biggest strength of this country, and Indian entrepreneurship is the strength. Now, everybody who is educated in the modern education, they are interested in having a good job and good salary. And we must appreciate. But where are the jobs? I am pointing to a bright future, not the question. Where are the jobs? In India, even today, more than 90% and 93% jobs are provided not by the corporate sector, where we are putting or where we are focusing, and we are interested in trying to find solutions for the problem. 93% employment is coming in a non-formal sector or informal sector or small industrial sector, industrial clusters or service sectors. Corporate sector, it is not more than 7%. And the public sector, if you take the organized sector, after 1991, the employment generation is coming down, it is a negative growth. So we have to connect this entrepreneurial India, which is not a corporate sector, but a very important sector, and which is providing economy, and the strength to the economy, which is providing the employment, and which is the real earner of the revenue for the country. So this is a very important strength on which, you know, many people now, lot of discussions, they go, market theory or market philosophy or capitalism or socialism or this ism and that ism. I am not interested in making the theories based on the book. But in India, even if you take the stock market, the people who invest in the stock market in India, from 2.5 to 3% to maximum it goes to 5%. The people who are saving in India and investing in the stock market is not more than 5%, not more than 4%, sometimes it is 2.5%. Whereas in America, American economy completely, it's a stock market driven company, whereas India is not a stock market driven company. So when you have 5% people say they're putting their savings in the stock market, even if you accelerate this growth, after 25 years, it is not going to become the 50%. So we have to understand what kind of muscle, what kind of power is going to pull this engine up. So this is a very important thing. Now the coming point, now when I come to talk about the savings and investment. So the problem in India is you have the banks. More than 70% and 80% of savings are deposited in the banks.
Finance Minister Chidambaram used to always talk about, so don't invest in the banks, please invest in the stock. Don't invest in the gold, please invest in the stock. People never used to believe Chidambaram, people never used to believe Manmohan Singh, because, you know, gold was more trustworthy than Chidambaram and Manmohan Singh. Indian women, they never trusted the Chidambaram and Manmohan Singh. They always built on purchasing the gold.
So you have to understand, Indian savings, in Japan, people save more, and in Japan, people put their savings in the bank. In America, people save, and if they don't have savings now, and people, whatever they are in the stock market. And in India, people save, and they save in the bank, and 70% of the deposits are saved in the public sector banks. So it is a bank driven, and it is a public sector bank driven. So in coming days, we have to understand the savings are, how those savings can be linked to the entrepreneur, the enterprising sector. This is going to be the important issue, which we have to understand. So entrepreneurs, educational institutions in coming days, the youth, they have to focus how to create solutions for the real economy of India, then we will have the real economy. If we are going to focus on the marginal area, maybe lucrative, marginal area, then we have little scope for the growth. We have to understand in coming days, the future lies in serving the manufacturing industry. That is the reason our Honorable Prime Minister, he has given a slogan that made in India is the market. Manufacturing in India is the market. Service sector, it is very important, and service sector has helped us, but service sector just alone cannot drive the growth of the country, then manufacturing sector is very important. Within that, I would like to mention two important areas in Hyderabad. Now India is a country which is aspiring to become a superpower, global power, and it wants to become a member in the Security Council. We want to become the member of the Security Council. 127 crore people not allowed to participate in the Security Council, it means that the institution itself is not a balanced. If India is not in UNO, then how you can call it as a balanced institution? And India is not there, Brazil is not there, South Africa is not there. And you understand the entire population, rural population is away from the administration, then how can you call it as a balanced institution? So India wants to enter into the Security Council. This country is giving a statement in support, and that country is giving a statement in support of making India as a Security Council. But do you understand? India, it's a big country. It has got a long border. You have got one China on the side, then that side, and Pakistan this side, and the entire maritime boundary. And you have a lot of investments, and the wealth is growing, and the economy is growing. And in this situation, and you have investments. People who have got the surplus and investing within the country and outside the country, you have more. And in coming days, savings are going to increase. And savings are going to be invested in outside countries, and you don't have the wisdom power. And you don't have the defense power. And you don't have the membership in the Security Council. How can your economy match with this kind of matter? So in such a situation, the arms and ammunition produced by others and imported by us and continuously, perpetually imported by others, this kind of situation, neither is going to help and support the political ambition, nor it is going to propel the industrial and economic growth. So we have to understand, all the students and young people who have some surplus, who have got some ideas, and who want to become entrepreneurs, who want to create surplus, who want to create wealth, and who want to provide employment,
you have to understand the opportunities are not outside, the opportunities are inside.
What the billions import, world largest importer, what kind of, and a person who cannot manufacture guns for India, how any day he can manufacture guns for America? So Indian entrepreneur is not able to supply to Hyderabad municipality, can supply to the New York municipality. How it can happen any day? If you see the channels which are here, if they are not able to provide services to Hyderabad or India or Tamil Nadu or Telangana, how they can become entrepreneurs are able to create entertainment material for the whole world? How it is possible? So we have to understand this entrepreneurship drive has a very important political agenda. Where we have state, we have to accelerate this process. The kind of, it's not just defense sector. If you see the kind of mobile phones, the kind of mobile phones, the kind of computer, the kind of things which we are using, and we are without the software power, but without the hardware supporting. And continuously importing. Do you know the sleeping bags for the soldiers are imported from China? The shoes which are taken for the soldiers are coming from China, rooted from Ireland or rooted from other countries. So Indian manufacturers or Indian entrepreneurs, they want an opportunity. And the kind of savings, you know, many people do not know, we do not have money. India does not have money. You know, if in the world, if any country has got money, it is only India. This is not a slogan. This is not a political slogan, a rhetoric. I am saying, if any country in the whole world has got money sitting on the capital, it is only India. You know, the percentage of savings, Indian savings, 35% of the GDP Indian savings, never less than 29%, and savings are coming from not the government or anybody or corporate sector, the savings are coming from the families. So you have to understand, Indian entrepreneur, he does not require the way America requires the foreigner. America, if it has to spend a day sustain its economy, it requires money from the Middle East, it requires money from Japan, it requires money from China, it requires money from India. And India does not require money the way other people require. I am not saying that foreign money is not required, but don't have the misimpression, we require the way others require. This kind of savings, nowhere. Only India has this. So the hardware superpower India can deliver. The defense manufacturing, self-reliance country, and afterwards we can also arm the other third world countries in the whole world. Only India can become the leader in producing the defense products. And we have the human brain. I already told the kind of Indian human brain you don't have anywhere. And the entertainment industry, do you know what kind of entertainment industry? This is a country of the listeners, the country of the holidays. There are many people who do not understand the importance of the holidays, and holidays have become more. And every 1 week you have a festival, then it's festival, Krishna festival, this festival and that festival. So don't, never these festivals allow a, you know, wealth getting concentrated in one place. It is every time distributed. And the leisure time is taken as a very important thing for the human. The leisure time which you have taken in this country, the way it is spent, nowhere in the world. And this is a Hollywood industry which is now dominating and trying to capture the Mexican and the Latin American countries, not now posing a challenge to France, posing a challenge to other European countries, not able to pose any kind of challenge to
in the army because India has got a strong entrepreneurial industry. One Hindi believe is sufficient to conquer the whole world. Now one Bahubali, what kind of waves it has created, you understand? This is the first part. And the entertainment industry not the only film. You know, 1,000 films produced in this single country. 22 languages. Telugu is one important industry. Hindi is one important film industry. Tamil is one important film industry. These kind of films are not produced anywhere in the world. And the TV channels and the entertainment products. So, what kind of employment future we have, we can understand through this employment in this entertainment. Now, our Prime Minister has given the culture and tourism. India becomes superpower not by becoming America. You know, if you become America, there is nothing to offer to the world. If you remain as India, there is everything to offer to the whole world. You know, many people who see that, you know, just money. And money also, in America has become a power in the money or in the military after 1945 after Second World War. Before that it was not a leader. After 1945, today it is 2015. Within 70 years, it has got tired. We have the capacity, once becoming the leader, we can remain as a leader nearly again for the 1,000 years. When I say this, I would like to, you know, Swami Vivekananda, you all know, it doesn't require any explanation. When he returned, after 1893, after making a great speech in Chicago, he has visualized and presented, you know, the quote, "The longest night seems to be passing away. The sorest trouble seems to be coming to an end at last. The seeming corpse appears to be awaking and a voice is coming to us. Everything. Now, like a breeze from the Himalayas, it is bringing life into the almost dead bones and muscles. The lethargy is passing away. Only the blind cannot see. The perverted will not see that she is awakening, this motherland of ours. From her deep, long sleep, none can resist her anymore. Never is she going to sleep anymore. No outward powers can hold her back anymore. But the infinite change is raising to her feet." Then he made this speech in 1897. Can you imagine? Believing this. In 1897, India is going to become a superpower and it is rising. Now the darkness is over, the clouds are gone. And now I am seeing clearly when he was saying, a mystic he was saying, but nobody was ready to listen to him. So we have to understand now the economy is shifting. That after 1757, the Plassey War, the power which has got transferred from the Asia and India to the West, now it is coming restored to India. It is coming to us. Not because of anybody's mercy, not because of anybody's sympathy, it is because of inherent strength which we have. We have to understand this. So the entrepreneurial India, when I say this, it is going to drive and the youth, the young people of India, they are going to drive the Indian story. One more important thing I would like. All these traditional things and family, and, you know, these things are with the state, with the government or without government, is going to. We have the 37%, 35% savings because we have the family. And America does not have the savings because the Americans do not have the family. Family cannot be created by the state or government or institution or this party or that. So we have
understand the community life, the family life, the social life, and the social capital which we have got in this country, this is making India powerful and this is making India excellent. Second important, the knowledge. You know, many people from North India, they do not sometimes know. They have got other evidences of the knowledge superiority. But I would like to give a knowledge superiority which is there even within tradition in Andhra Pradesh, which is Ashtavadana, Shatavadana, Sahasravadana. You tell me, hey, they are giving this statement, are talking about this, are talking about that. Are Rahul Gandhi making this first or that first or that this or that slip? Anything discussed not just in Delhi, not just in BITS Pilani, Hyderabad, it is discussed in every corner of the country within 24 hours. What kind of political education, political consciousness, political dynamism, literate and illiterate? Many times, many people say, illiterate, they sell their votes. Many people have the impression, but whenever the opportunity came, whenever the challenge came before the country, these very people, they might have taken money, but they never sold the vote at the point of view. They know what is the important challenge for the country. Whenever the challenge is there, and whenever a leader has come, the society and this illiterate community, they also exhibited their capacity to transcend from their level parochial levels. They were nanometrics, ability to raise and transcend to the level of the national challenge. That is exhibited here in this country. So this electoral system, you do not have this kind of election commission. Tomorrow in coming days, whole world will have to learn from the Indian election commission system. How to conduct the elections. Even Americans, they cannot conduct elections in the Indian election commission conduct. We have some shortcomings, we have some problems, but compared to other, the kind of counting process, the way we declare the result, you do not have anywhere in the world this kind of. And how many votes? More than 841 million votes. More than 60% people cast their vote. This kind of population getting into the political process, nowhere it is happening. So with this, I know the problems. I know the challenges. But the problems and challenges can overcome because we have the necessary strength. The strength which is there, not just now, from time to time. So this is a very important. So India is going to be the very important power at the global. And this global power, unlike America, unlike European powers, unlike China, it is going to be the party, our government, our country, our nation, which is going to help other nations in addressing their problems. We are going to spread the education, we are going to spread the knowledge. You know, the number of teachers we can provide to the whole world, no country can provide. There is a country of teachers. In coming days, Africa requires Indian teachers. Asian countries, they require Indian teachers. It is not only nurses, they require teachers. So in coming days, the global, wherever the need is there, Indians are going to play a major role. So with these things, what I would like to make here is, we have certain challenges in the political area, challenges in the education, challenges in the technology, challenges in the economy. Everywhere they have challenges. We have certain shortcomings. We have certain deficits. And we have also certain distortions. Every human being has got sanity and insanity, or some kind of positive and some kind of negative. As long as the positive prevails, the person becomes sublimated and divine. Near to that. So India has that capacity. And In coming days, my appeal to the students of the campuses like BITS, take up the problems of the real working economies. If they are able to take the problem of the certain area, then profits will be more. And giving you an incentive, it is not a service. It is not just a service, a charity service. The profit will be more. Shall I say, sir, one important thing in India, when I say profit, if you go to, you know, any vendor, vegetable vendor, or a rickshaw driver, or any person, the interest rate, if you ask, what is the interest rate? If you go to any entrepreneur also, here in Qatar, Jerua, in this area, you go to any small entrepreneur to go and ask what is the interest area with which they are accessing at rate. Sometimes it is 2 rupees, sometimes it is 3 rupees, sometimes it goes to 5 rupees. If we are able to create solutions for these things, the profits will be more for the solutions. So important thing is, in the coming days, working in India, I have got more profits. Working in other countries may not have the kind of profits. So the country has to produce such kind of people who have got real knowledge and real conviction, real commitment to the Indian situation. With this, I once again thank the Professor Rao for inviting me here and to present some of my ideas with you. Thank you. I am the Vice Chancellor for the Rao to felicitate the guest with the memento and the talk.